Hello, friends and neighbors. I just want to take a quick minute to talk about Betsy DeVos. Oh, Betsy, Betsy, Betsy. You confound me a little bit. The reason I want to talk about Betsy DeVos, and in general, this election cycle, cabinet appointees, and the hearings surrounding them, is because I don't think that a large portion of social media is really engaging their brains, at least not enough, right? So with the specific example of the Secretary of Education in mind, I wanted to bring up a few points. And let me preface them by saying that I am no Donald Trump supporter. I self-identify as a liberal, or at least I used to. Now, most of my political leanings are still pretty darn liberal. I suppose across the board, maybe I'd be more accurately described as a moderate, but I'm a pretty liberal person in my beliefs. However, I do believe in using sound logic and using facts to support your arguments and doing your research. And especially, and this is the thing about liberalism, you know, it's about freedom, right? And it's about progress. It's about evolution. But in order to get those things, you need debate, you need discourse, and you need to listen to people that have other ideas, you know, from your own. And that's how you really grow your ideas, not by shutting down arguments, not by using propaganda to convince people that what you're saying or what you believe is right. Okay, so what I've noticed overall in this election cycle from both sides is that they tend to employ memes and social media streams and YouTube clips instead of full videos and take things out of context, take statements out of context, and over-exaggerate the holy heck out of things that occur, right? Now, this is very effective. Propaganda is effective for a reason, and that's because when you, as a human, you know, when we play on your heartstrings, you know, as a liberal, you like to think you're a good person. You know, you support equal rights, you support civil rights, you support equal opportunity. And those are awesome things. They're great things. They are at the very base of our society, right? So when somebody tells you over and over again that this person doesn't believe in those things, that this person is going to take those things away from you, you as a good person react by saying, hell no, I'm not going to stand for that. And you shouldn't stand for that. But you should stand for reason, you should stand for logic, and you should research these things, because the political and monetary-based motives of a lot of people, YouTube vloggers included, is to make money, is to gain power and influence, right? They don't necessarily care about the little guy. They say they do, but that's their political platform. Look at, you know, even, and I hate to say this because I think Barack Obama was a very good president. And I like the guy. I like him personally. He's very, you know, charismatic, and I like most of his policies. But if you look at income inequality in this country, it's greater than it was when he got elected. Racial divides are worse off than when he was elected president. I think that's pretty safe to admit. You know, when all these, you know, when all this Ferguson and things like that happened, it wasn't because of Trump. You know, this happened during Obama's presidency. Anyway, I digress. Basically, my point is, I'm a relatively liberal guy, but I want us to think about what we're doing. So let's discuss Betsy DeVos just for a minute, okay? Prior to the Senate confirmation hearing, the first one, I believe there's two, right, for all those people. And I want to say this really quickly, too. When Mr. Arne was being confirmed, or any of the other cabinet nominations for Clinton or for Bush or for anybody else, were we watching them? Because everybody's watching them now. Did you watch Obama's appointees? No, you weren't concerned about that, but you're concerned about Trump's, right? Because he's coming to eat your babies, and so are they. Sorry, again, I don't like Trump. I think he's a total douchebag. But, like, all of a sudden now you're concerned, right? Because he's going to appoint people that are taking away your rights. Again, sorry, I digress. So, the position of Secretary of Education. The ostensible reasons for Betsy DeVos not being qualified. She's rich. She's, well, I'm not going to say white, but I guarantee you, a lot of you are thinking rich white lady, right? Private school, educated, has no experience in financial aid because she didn't receive any. That's an argument you heard. Let's see here. She went to private school. Does not have a degree in education. Was never a teacher. Those are the main, I guess, tenets, right? And she's a Christian, which is awful. You can't be a white, rich Christian. That's just a terrible thing to be. So, I did a little bit of research, like I like to do. pretty much all of the previous candidates or office holders, excuse me, were most of those things. Only I think three were actually teachers before they got their office. Mr. Arne, again, who was not that great of a Secretary of Education, was basically forced to resign because he was so unpopular with the main teachers' unions in this country. Introduced Common Core, which I think is just a moronic system of education. You know, was the CEO of Chicago Public Schools, where, you know, pretty much anybody who's from Chicago can tell you that that's not exactly a badge of honor. But anyway, he wasn't a teacher. The guy who succeeded him was a teacher. And there's one or two other guys which are like, you know, high school teachers. But here's the thing. So out of nine, I think maybe three were teachers, right? Almost all of them went to private school for primary education. Almost all of them went to elite secondary education institutions. I think only one, maybe two, actually had education-related degrees. They were almost all political science degrees, a couple business degrees and things like that. But so almost very few teachers, all public school educated, or all private school educated pretty much, all fairly wealthy, all politically involved, most politically involved. The majority solely held political positions, or mostly held political positions before they were appointed. It's a back-scratching thing, right? It happens with Democrats and Republicans. Is it right? Probably not. Does it happen all the time? It does. But remember, the Secretary of Education, just like all other cabinet posts, is a political position. She's not going to be a teacher. She's not even going to be a principal. So you need somebody who is politically adept, right? Who's got that acumen, who knows sort of the ins and outs and how you deal with things and how you get things done, because that's what essentially she's going to be doing, dealing with the teachers' unions. I think is maybe a slight oversimplification of what a secretary does in a cabinet, but basically the secretaries, especially from what I've seen in these Senate hearings, is they listen to other politicians who are talking about the problems that they have in their districts. They listen to probably more lobbies than you'd want to admit, but they listen to constituencies, and other politicians, in this particular instance, teachers' unions and union representatives. They figure out by doing research and by listening to these people what the problems are, and also, you know, from existing research, what the problems are, and then they try to come to a consensus about how to fix these problems. Now, most teachers would probably just tell you they need to be paid better and they need to have better working conditions. So, I mean, yeah, that's a no-brainer, right? At the same time, you know, accountability is a big thing, I think. I'm not going to talk too much about the policies because that's just pointless. But so the first point is putting her up on a cross before she even spoke a word in the Senate confirmation hearings is ludicrous, because for the reasons that we've discussed. Because pretty much all the other office holders have had the same qualifications on paper. You know, I don't think that any of the things that they're talking about are detractors. She's a proven philanthropist in both the arts and in education-related avenues. And her husband founded in 1989 a company which, among other things, donates a lot of money to researching renewable green energy. I'm not sure how many of you knew that. Yes, she's very Republican. She's very Christian, and in many ways conservative. But she has helped out a lot of kids. You know, she's concerned with green energy, which I think doesn't fit the narrative, right? I think she really, really wants the children in this country to be well-educated. She's helped out a lot of, like, when I say kids, poor kids, you know, she's helped out a lot of them. Does that make her qualified to be the Secretary of Education? No, not necessarily. Of course not. You know, but also, does it mean that she's not qualified, the other things? No, again, it doesn't, right? But just because Trump nominated her, there's millions of people who automatically think she's unqualified, right? Even though her qualifications as a politician, as a person who really cares and is active in the education community, are pretty good. And, you know, definitely as good as other people who've held the post before. So, you know, when you're talking about her evasive question answering in the Senate hearings, she's a politician. You know, you don't, in a Senate hearing, want to commit too thoroughly to specific things, and you're not going to offer a whole heck of a lot of specific details in terms of minutiae and numbers when you're being questioned by these senators. One is because you have a 5-minute limit per questionee or questioner, I guess. And the other is because to commit to something before you take office is political suicide. I mean, she has yet to develop all her policies. She has yet to meet with all the advisors and other people who are going to be working in the department to see what they really want to get done, right? So for her to say, yes, I commit absolutely to this, or no, I don't commit to that, it would be counterintuitive at best. So, of course, she's a politician. She's going to be sort of evasive, especially if she doesn't have an answer that's going to be suitable to the people that she knows she's talking with, right? That being said, two things do bug me a little bit. One is the answer about guns in school. She couldn't categorically or wholesalely say that guns in school are bad. I think we can all agree as a society that unless there's a police officer at your school who has a gun to keep the peace, guns should be kept the heck out of schools. And her argumentation was there's one place in Wyoming where they have a grizzly bear fence because there's grizzly bears and you might need a gun to shoot that grizzly bear. Sorry, that's no good to me. So you screwed that one up pretty badly, Betsy. The other one is the fact that she was not familiar with IDEA, which is basically the Kids with Disabilities Act, guaranteeing a certain degree of education, certain level of education for people with disabilities and special needs children. So a lot of people, and people that I know, are very concerned about this, and well, they should be. You know, you'd say an educator, especially someone who's the highest position in regards to educational policy development in this country, doesn't know about the act. Now, again, I haven't gotten far enough into the actual hearings. It's like a 3.5 hour long thing. I haven't gotten far enough into it to really see if it's been taken out of context or not. And I have a feeling it might be because a lot of things are. A lot of things have been in this election cycle and even post-election. So I will say if that is true, it's kind of shame on you there, Betsy. I mean, you definitely need to know about that sort of stuff. The education and overall caretaking of special needs people and people with disabilities in this country is very important. You know, we can't just leave them behind because they're different. I think people would generally agree with that. So those two points, I think she kind of dropped the ball for sure. So, you know, is she the best candidate? Again, I'm not saying she is. I'm not saying she isn't. But what I am saying is that some of the lines of questioning and some of the reasons that she is being discounted for this office, I think, are invalid. Example, Elizabeth Warren, right? Elizabeth Warren's line of questioning basically consisted of asking Betsy DeVos a bunch of questions that she already knew the answer to and that we already know the answer to. Her basic inquiry was, you know, did you go to public school? No. Yeah, we already knew that. You know, do you have any experience with public school? No. Do you have any experience with Pell Grants or with assigning loans to people? Or do you have any experience in a bank, basically, I think she asked her at one point in time. Of course she doesn't. But, you know, neither did any of the people who came before her, and probably neither will any of the people who come after her. That's why you have more than one person who works in the Department of Education. There are specialists in every regard, you know. And back to the previous point, I just want to say that just because she was ignorant of the IDEA Act, which was originally passed in 1975, right? I think the last bit of legislation for it was like in 2012, and it was kind of an add-on to an add-on. It doesn't mean that she is ignorant of the needs of special needs people and people with disabilities and children with disabilities. It doesn't mean that she's going to take away their rights. It doesn't mean that she's going to defund education for them. It doesn't mean any of those things. And if you listen to her talk, I think it's very obvious that she is passionate about people receiving, children in this country receiving a good education. Okay, so back to Elizabeth Warren. Asking her all these questions about things that are not her area of expertise is really sort of, they call it a straw man nowadays, you know, or the red herring. It's you know, you could ask me all sorts of questions about, you know, nuclear physics or something like that. I won't be able to answer them because I'm not a nuclear physicist. You know, that doesn't mean I can't head a department that involves the discussion or the application of nuclear physics. You know, there are literally, I think, probably what, at least hundreds of people in the Department of Education that work actually in Washington, and they hire people, you hire great people and you hire intelligent minds who have different specializations, different areas of specialization, so that they can advise you, so that you can develop the best policies and then implement those policies to help the children of your country get good educations, right? Now, that being said, again, it does surprise me that she didn't know about it. And it is kind of worrying. So, you know, if they don't confirm her, which I, you know, they probably will, but if they don't confirm her, I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. And again, the Secretary of Education, I think probably a lot like the President of the United States, is kind of a figureheadish position. They need somebody, you know, who speaks well, who dresses nicely, who's got a little bit of education, is relatively intelligent, you know, and who has a general desire to serve the country, to work with all the people who are doing the real grunt work, you know? Because it's all the advisors, it's all the teachers that advise her, it's all the, you know, it's all the people that she has under her in the cabinet that are really doing the work, that are really getting things done. And then she goes around and schmoozes the congressmen and the senators and the representatives and the school districts and says, hey, this is what we're thinking, let's get it done. But that's after everybody came together and, you know, developed the policy. So basically, again, I get long-winded on these things just because, you know, it's great, just because I'm passionate about the issue. It's great that we're talking about it as a nation. It's great that people are actually watching Senate confirmation hearings to sort of see what's going on. But I just want everyone out there to, whether or not you agree with her, because, you know, after watching the hearings and, you know, do some research online, see what she's about. And after all that, if you think she's not suited for the job, I fully support your decision in that. And I'm not really sure what my decision is, but, you know, it's not a vote. Well, it's a vote in the Senate, but it's not a vote for, you know, you and me to make. So, but it is reflective of the whole sort of socio-political climate that we are encountering now. And for liberals out there, for conservatives out there, please, let's try and use our brains. Let's try and come together as a nation, whether or not you like Trump or hate Trump or this or that. Keep in mind, he is one guy. You know, he is one guy at the top. And, you know, we need to watch what's going on, sure. But let's not just say that everything involved with this one guy is crap, you know. We're all on the boat. We don't want the boat to sink. I think we can all agree with that. But the only way for the boat not to sink is for us to all paddle hard, right? And trust me, if Trump does intern Muslims, which he already pretty much has said he's not, if he does, you know, take away civil rights and civil liberties for people, I will be right out there protesting with you. But the guy hasn't even taken office yet, and already he's the worst president in the United States, and he's going to literally, I saw a meme, and the bottom of the meme was, he's going to kill us all. I mean, literally, that's not true, right? So stop the fear-mongering, stop the bloody hatred, let's come together a little bit. Let's consider people and things for what they are and for what who they are and for what things are. Make our decisions based on that rather than silly emotion, which was propagated by awful memes, social media posts, and propaganda. That's all for this time. See you next time.